Music in the Morgan Manor, the life and music of Russ Morgan, with the music of Russ Morgan and the words of Mrs. Shirley Morgan.
Hello, folks. This is Russ Morgan. Before we start the show, I just want to say hello and thanks for joining us. We have some smooth arrangements of some great song hits on tap for today, and we hope you like them. So without wasting any more time, here we go with our first number.
You're nobody till somebody loves you. You're nobody till somebody cares. You may be king, you may possess the world and its gold, but gold won't bring you happiness when you're growing old. The world still is the same, you'll never change it. As sure as the stars shine above, you're no nobody till somebody loves you. So find yourself somebody to love.
Welcome to part two of this series looking at the life of American musician and bandleader Russ Morgan. Now, let's continue with our interview with Mrs. Shirley Morgan.
Now, over the years, Russ Morgan had a lot of featured singers. They weren't what I'd call name singers, but by golly, they could carry a tune. Talk a little bit about some of the people that you remember from the band in those days.
Oh, they had some wonderful... Unfortunately, they never became as big stars as some of the other band leaders. But Carolyn Clark was my best friend in the band. She was a delightful person. I am not in touch with her too much now because geographically we have moved all over the countries. But she was a darling singer. And then there was a Gloria Whitney, who was one of these sultry type singers. And Mert Curtis, who was a saxophone player in the band, he was a singer. Ralph Brewster was in the band. He played trumpet, but he was also one of the more modern heirs with Glenn Miller later on.
Yes.
And Louis Julian, who Russ discovered him, he was a page boy at NBC Studios when Russ used to do his shows from there.
In New York City.
And Louis Julian came over to Russ and he said, "May I sing with your band?" And Russ said, "You're a page boy. What are you going to do singing?" He said, "Well, I don't want to be a page boy all my life," he said, "but would you let me sing one song?" And he was very, very good. So Russ had him in the orchestra for a while. And Jimmy Lewis was the guitar player. He did a lot of the vocals. He had a lot of the musicians who would double playing instruments and singing.
Right. Yes, I've got a lot of Russ's recordings, and I think that the vocalists are up there with the best of them.
Yes.
And it's intriguing that none of them really were named singers, but my gee, they did well.
And you know how, if I may tell you a story, I don't think I ever told you this one, the way Russ started to sing. He was only a musician, an instrumentalist, and when he was recording director, there was another band. And I don't know whether it was Archie Blyer or Al Cavalin or one of those names from years back. And he had a girl singer who was trying to sing Broadway's Gone Hawaii and another song. It's 100 years old. I can't remember the name right now. And they could not get the girl to sing the song the way they wanted it to. And Al Cavalin said, whatever her name was, try to sing it this way, and they did it over and over. So Russ said, "Let me show her how it should be done." So he started singing the song. He said, "Sing it this way." So when the orchestra leader heard it, he said, "Russ, I like the way you're singing it better than she is." And he said, "Would you be on my date?" Russ said, "I'm the recording manager. I can't sing in here." He said, "Yes, you can." So he sang those two songs. Broadway Rhythm was one, and I'll think of the others later, maybe. But he sang Four Sides. And when the recording people at Brunswick heard that, they said, "Russ, this is wonderful. Do some recordings on your own time and your own name." And that's how he started singing. Otherwise, he had no intention of singing. And Russ was a big man. He always said he looked like a football player. And he had sort of, in the beginning, when he first started singing, he had a tenor voice.
Mm-hmm.
Later on, it became baritone.
Yes.
But he said, "Here I am. I look like a football player, and listen to me with my tenor voice." But he enjoyed singing, and he used to sing with the same intonation that he played the trombone, the same, I don't know the musical term, but the same tones.
Right.
Beautiful. The same inflection.
That's great. Wonderful.
So tired of waiting for you, so tired of longing for you, tired of waiting, saving my love for you. So tired of dreaming daydreams, so tired of only play schemes. Why don't you call me tonight, my dear? Tell me that your thoughts are all of me, sweetheart. All day long I wonder why we're far apart. So tired of dreaming of you, so tired of waiting for you. But though I'm tired, I'll wait forever, dear. Thank you. tired of dreaming of you, so tired of waiting for you. But though I'm tired, I'll wait forever, dear.
One of Russ's most popular recordings is So Tired, and Russ provided the vocal on that arrangement of A Lovely Song. Now this time we feature Russ and his Wolverine band with the Old Piano Roll Blues. Russ and Eddie Wilser are on dual Steinways, and George Van Epps stars on guitar.
Really, something that we haven't touched on to date, and I think it's a very important component of Russ's life, is his composing.
Oh, yes.
He wrote some wonderful songs. Yes. Tell us a little bit about the songs.
Well, the first song that he wrote that became a big hit was his theme song, Does Your Heart Beat For Me? And that, to this day, they are still recording it. I'm still getting royalties. God bless him. Does Your Heart Beat For Me? Was written... He wrote the music mostly, but Mitchell Parrish, who wrote Stardust, and Tommy Dorsey's Up Getting Sentimental Over You, he wrote the words to
the lyricist, yeah.
Does Your Heart Beat For Me?
Mm-hmm.
And then Russ wrote the closing theme song, So Tired, and So Long. And So Tired became a big hit over in England during the war. It became a bigger hit there. We were publishing it. We had, by that time, Russ and I were married. We had our own publishing company. And suddenly we're getting all these royalties from England. And I don't know how they got the song, but I guess during the wartime it was, Although I'm Tired, I'll Wait Forever, Dear. So, and then he wrote So Long, So Tired. Then his biggest song, You're Nobody Till Somebody Loves You, that has been recorded by over 275 people, every kind of an arrangement that you could think of, ballads, jazz, pop, rock and roll. I mean, some of them are so awful that I think, well, I'm getting royalties, so I'll forgive them.
Exactly. Now, the other night I opened the program with You're Nobody Till Somebody Loves You with Jimmy Durante singing.
Oh, I didn't know he did that.
He did
really?
Yes, on an LP.
Oh, my.
It was one of the last things I think he did.
Oh, that must have been something.
It was. It was. I must let you hear it sometime.
Oh, yes.
But he did write some beautiful things. One of my favorites, I think, is So Long. So Tired.
So Tired, yes.
So Tired. And I had a some people over to the house just recently, and the mother said, would you have Russ Morgan So Tired?
Oh, really?
So I got it out on 78 and played it. And she said, you know, we used to skate to this at St. Moritz, which was a skating rink in St. Kilda.
Oh,
no longer
for
there.
Heaven's sake,
but they used to
wonderful?
Skate to that.
Oh.
And I can see that.
Oh, yeah,
you know?
Right.
You know,
we
it's
used to skate to the Merry Widow Waltz.
It's a beautiful piece.
Yes.
It is a very nice piece. So that's my memories, and every time that I feel sentimental, I put So Tired on, because I think it's lovely. But the first record of Russ Morgan's that I had, and I can remember playing, was Forever and Ever.
Oh, yeah, well, he didn't write that.
No.
If I might digress a moment, he also wrote Somebody Else Is Taking My Place, which Peggy Lee recorded.
Yes.
When she was singing with Benny Goodman.
Mm-hmm.
Kay Starr recorded So Tired. The Mills Brothers did You Nobody Till Somebody. Well, as I said, 275 people did You
That's
Nobody Till Somebody
people.
Loves You.
I mean, that must be one of the most recorded songs.
I think so. And after Russ died, for about 4 or 5 years, ASCAP, which is the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers,
mm-hmm.
Awarded a prize to him, or to the family now, for having the best theme song that was continuous play and recordings. I don't know how many recordings of that. It's been in a lot of movies. In fact, a movie just came out recently. I can't remember the name of it. That had Does Your Heartbeat for Me in it. Many movies have Your Nobody Till Somebody Loves It. And my grandson, who, as I said before, is in the Army, and he does nothing but listen to videos, and he'll call up, Grandma, they have such and such a song. Grandpa's song is in this movie and that. But he wrote Somebody Else Is Taking My Place, and Flower of Dawn, which he wrote that we get more requests for, more people love it. It never sold, but it was one of his favorite.
It's a beautiful,
beautiful
song, and why don't we listen to that right now?
Oh, that's lovely. Thank you.
Flower of dawn, our love was like a flower that's newly born, just like a bud that was so closely pressed. It blossomed when the moon went west. Something rare. We were two strangers at a strange affair. I asked you for a dance, and with your smile, life at last appeared worthwhile. In between each dance, we'd watch the stars above. Suddenly, a voice within said, this is love, this is love. Flower of dawn, we stole a lover's kiss at early morn, and with that kiss a lover's name was born. Our name for love was Flower of Dawn. Thank you.
A lovely tune, played and sung in fine style by Russ and the orchestra, with Russ providing the vocal on Flower of Dawn. Now the Morganaires join the band with a Russ Morgan composition, Somebody Else is Taking My Place.
Let's continue on, and I note from the discography, and I'm referring to this quite a bit, but the band did a number of broadcasts, quite a lot, in fact, from the Hotel Claremont in Berkeley in California.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about the Berkeley situation.
Well, I almost blew that whole job for Russ. We had just finished the Edgewater Beach Hotel in Chicago, and our youngest child was just maybe 2 or 3 months old, and when the engagement was over, we went back to my home in New York City, actually in Long Island, and once we got there, Russ got a call from his agent that there's a hotel in Berkeley. We had never heard of Berkeley. We didn't even know where Berkeley, California was. It was just a small, outside of Oakland, California, actually, and it was just a little area, and they wanted, it was a beautiful hotel, but the man was losing a lot of money, and he said he's going to do one great big
go out with a bang type thing.
Right. He'll either make it or it'll break him. But he said he wants the Russ Morgan Orchestra. He checked through the Bay Area to see what orchestras had been doing well. And they checked that the Mark Hopkins and the Palace Hotel, that when Russ worked there, they did the best business of any other band. So he said, I want the Russ Morgan Orchestra. So Russ's agent called, and he said, we would like you to go open the hotel in Oakland at Claremont Hotel. And I said, honey, we can't. I said, I have just moved from Chicago back to New York. I said, they had told us in Chicago we were halfway there. So Russ said, I'm sorry, my wife won't go. Well, they didn't take no for an answer. They called up, we'll offer you $500 a week more. And Russ said, well, that sounds interesting. I said, I don't care about the money. I said, I just cannot physically take three little babies and go there. Well, they kept calling up and calling up, and they said, we will give you a free suite in the hotel. So I said, I don't want to live in a, I mean, I was being very, very bad. I didn't want to go, and whatever they offered us, I had something terrible to say about it.
You dug your heels in other words.
Absolutely, thank you. And I said, I don't want to live in a hotel. I said, living in a hotel with three babies, I said, we'd have to have room service every day. Where would they play? And I said, I'm sorry, I won't go. And in the meantime, I felt like I was playing God, because there were 19 people in the band who were waiting to find out, where do we play next? Where do we work next? And they all had families, so they had to make plans. So I said, I don't want to live in a hotel with the children. So they called back a couple of days later. The owners of the hotel had very dear friends who lived right across the street and had a beautiful home. Their family had grown up and left, so they were going to have the two people, husband and wife, move into the hotel and give their home to us. And I think I had something to say about that too, and Russ said, now, honey, that's it. We are going there. But I said, for 2 months? I said, I can't take that move. We went there for 2 years. There for 2 years. We became the best friends of the people who gave their home, said, musicians, three little babies coming in. They took everything that was not nailed down. They hid their pots and their pans and their good things. And then when we met the lady, and she became a very good friend, she said, Shirley, I have a toaster downstairs. Would you like that? I have a roasting pan. Would you like that? I have this and that. So she started bringing her things in. But as I said, the engagement lasted for 2 years, and Russ was a hit. They broadcast, as you can tell from the discography, I think they broadcast three or four times a week, coast to coast, and it helped Russ's career a lot, beside the fact that we stayed there for 2 years, beside the fact we had another baby.
You enjoyed it?
Yes, it was a beautiful place.
And tell me, did it save the hotel?
Yes. Oh, the hotel was the biggest thing that the man built additions to that. He kept giving raises to Russ every time. Well, he kept him on for 2 years.
Wonderful.
And after Russ decided, well, 2 years is enough here, and he wanted to go down to Los Angeles so that he could record down there and be near the motion picture studios and get a little bit more variety in the orchestra. But it did save the hotel, and Mr. and Mrs. Gillen became millionaires because of that.
Wow.
And they sold it at a very, very marvelous price. Oh, and the Mullen sisters used to sing with Russ, and the Lang sisters. He always had groups of girls. And one interesting story, at one time when Russ had girl singers, he had two sisters called the Little Sisters, L-Y-T-T-L-E, and they used to harmonize, and they were lovely, just young girls. And we had two musicians in the band, trumpet players, Vin Shank and Cappy Lewis, who was a marvelous studio. After a while, he became a marvelous studio trumpet player. Well, the two girls and the two trumpet players fell in love, married, and quit the band. So Russ said, that's the last time I'm ever going to have girls singers in the band. Invariably, they come in, they marry a musician, and I lose two people. This time, he lost four, two trumpets and two. I'm still very friendly with the two girls singers. They live in Las Vegas.
Is that a fact?
And I see them a lot.
Wonderful.
And the one trumpet, Cappy Lewis, has since died. But we still are in touch with a lot of the musicians. I guess they touch our lives and stay forever.
Terrific.
So long. Gee, I hate to see you go.
Music in the Morgan Manor. The life and music of Russ Morgan was written, produced, and narrated by Alex Hare for Lanair Enterprises.
You've been mine so long.
That just about does it. We've gone through our musical menu for today. Hope you enjoyed listening as much as we enjoyed singing and playing for you. Until the next time, when we present another melodic bill of fare featuring music in the Morgan Manor as the main dish, this is Russ Morgan saying so long.